Let's have a bit of controversy corner with the jingle.
Controversy, 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 controversy.
I wrote all the words to this.
Controversy, 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 controversy.
Good. I sang that bit. And we've been changing things around this year because we've got a new feature which I'm calling the Wheel of Controversy.
It's very exciting.
Yes, okay. Oh, it's the Wheel of Controversy. So we're going to load in the randomizer. What we did was we asked for topics and we picked the most controversial ones and we put them on the Wheel of Controversy and then we start the randomizer. I'll just start the randomizer now and that will pick the topic.
Well, most of you must be wondering what it actually means. So let me try and explain.
Well, I think maybe we buy too many new magic props. And all the dealers are going, no!
I wonder which side I'm going to fall on this argument.
I wonder which one. When really we should be working on what we've got. It worries me when I look at the internet sites and people are advertising, I want this prop immediately, and then 2 weeks later they're selling it. And they've not given it the slightest bit of chance, and they'll say, it's not me. How did they know after 2 weeks?
That's fine.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. I started my Charlie routine that I've now made my living off, I do everywhere I go, and it died in its arse for like 6 months.
Only that long?
Yeah. Okay, I always say it takes about 100 goes at anything before you even start.
What are you up to now, about 80?
Yeah, something like that. No, but I mean, what do we think? This is the forum where we can get some. What do you think, Jeremy?
Is there anybody out there who would like to offer an opinion? Do you think you buy far too much stuff?
Has anybody got anything in the cupboards they never use? And still go to a convention and buy more? Put it in the cupboard.
And how many ever go back to the cupboard, take something out, and think, I'm going to sit down and really work at this. I liked it when I bought it, I'm going to make it work. Does anybody ever do that? Occasionally.
Well, I think, I suppose the other argument is, do you want to constantly have the same show for 20 odd years and never change anything? And obviously there's extremes. So how do you work in new material? How does anybody work in new material? Do you start with a brand new show? Because I'm amazed as well, because people put on the internet and say like, I've got a new theme show, I'm doing it on Sunday. I'd be crapping my pants.
Jeremy,
I've got to go out and do a new theme show.
Many years ago, I was doing Electrical Magicians. If it's old, it's new.
Yes.
So what I did, I picked out 20 items out of things I hadn't got, and found 20 items that I'd bought, and related that there was nothing new from the old ones I had before to the new ones I bought. So really, I think I'm on John's side. Get it out of the loft and start polishing it up.
Yeah, I think really that's
what they are. That's an encouragement for all of you.
Yeah, just start polishing it in the loft. I do that all the time. So I think you do need to work new stuff in. What I normally do if I'm working new stuff, I don't know about anybody else, but what I normally do if I'm working new stuff in is I will take the prop to the show with me in the case and then do my normal show and then go home. And that goes on for like 6 months. I just basically am a taxi service for this prop between. I take it to shows with me and I don't even touch it. And then I'll get brave if I'm doing a show at somewhere like Cadbury World and all the kids come in for a second show. And I think, I'll try that one out. And then I'll try it out and I think, it's not too bad. And then I'll put it back in the case again for 6 months. And then it starts going in with more regularity and more frequency as we go along.
So sounds like quite a long process.
It's a very long process. But does anybody else do that?
Yeah.
think you've got to keep looking for new
stuff.
I think
you've tapped into a nerve here, John.
Well, I think you've got to keep looking for new stuff. But I think you haven't got to constantly say, right, we've got to put all this as... Because kids grow up anyway, and then you've got a new audience. That's one thing about our job. The audience recycles itself every 4 or 5 years.
And now I'd like to cast a spell over you all that you never heard this argument at all. Dealers will be open at 9 o'clock in the morning.
No, but, do you know, I the same puppet, same routine for my vent routine for years and years and years. But I've worn 14 of those puppets out and bought 14.
Is this going live?
No, we're not going to put this on the internet, we'll put that bit. But, you know, so I think people buy replacements of you, they wear it. Surely it's something you've used the prop, got a lot out of it,
oh, yes, of course,
and then came back and bought another one when it came out. That would be better than...
Not better.
We see this at conventions all the time. We go to Blackpool with 20 new routines. And people say, oh, that's great. And then you go to another convention 2 months later and they say, what's new? And that's all, oh, nobody's interested in that anymore. All the 20 are now old. We don't want them anymore.
So, John, in all the time you were just using Charlie,
yep.
How many other puppets did you buy when you were just using Charlie?
About 50. Yeah. I'm not saying I'm not afflicted with this disease, but I am. I've got cupboards full of tone. Shall we spin the wheel again?
Yeah. I'm just wondering what's going to come up this time.
Let's spin the wheel one more time.
Dear.
The topic is bargain basement magic shows are killing... I don't know if I'm looking, I did the film. bargain basement magic shows are killing the business. What do we think about that?
Well, I would think that this is pretty topical. Because in any recession, you get a large number of people who suddenly think, oh, I could become a children's entertainer. How difficult can that be?
Stand in front of a few people.
We're having a problem.
Could become a sound technician, I suppose. Could be.
Working fine at rehearsal, I promise. Rehearsal. Like this is planned.
But it always happens in a recession that people just think children's entertaining is easy until they try it. And then you find that standing in front of 30 little monsters is actually an awful lot more difficult than you ever thought it was. And things like pacing and timing and control, all of those things you suddenly realise that you don't have.
You know, I'm going to argue from an unusual viewpoint here, because thinking about it, I think bargain-based magic shows are not the problem. Cheap. I don't mind having competitors who are lower priced than me, because there are people who will shop at Lidl, and there are people who will not even touch a cheap entertainer with a bargain. And cheap entertainers who are good will put the price up. So I think really it should be bad magic shows are killing the business.
Yeah.
Because I'd rather be competing with somebody who is awful. Was really good, rather, and really cheap, than somebody who was awful and very expensive, because people are going to look at that and say, I'm never booking one again. So I think...
Is anybody here going to be brave enough to actually put up their hand and say
I'm not very good, I'm offended by that. You see, he's self-policing this, no one can get offended.
No.
Attacking the bad magicians. The bad magicians, put your hand up. See, that was offended. Fantastic.
No, I was going to ask, is there anybody here who's brave enough to put up their hand and say they'd cut the price of their show? Because of the recession. Right? Can't actually see, but I think I saw one hand go up there.
One hand, and a lot of people who are not telling the truth. I don't think, I've not cut my price, but I've started offering 2-hour parties, which I never did, and I always said I never would. I always said I'd never do them. And so I thought, well, I better start offering that and doing that, so I happen to do certain things. So I say it's not, I don't think it's anything to do with the price, because I was 10 quid when I started out. I was 15, and 10 quid was like...
Overpriced.
5 weeks, yeah. Oh. It was probably awful. And so I'm glad I wasn't charging anymore. I never, you know, as you get better, you change your name, move to another area, and put your price up, and then forget about it. Actually, with YouTube now, that's the worst thing about YouTube, isn't it? People can film you when you're crap. in the early days. Luckily, no film. It's about one bit of film of me that exists when I was being awful, because somebody showed it me. I was around the house and said, I read you when you were 15. I was the most awful. All my illusions.
Can we get hold of it?
No. All my illusions about how good I was when I was 15 went out the window when I watched it. I was terrible. But I was only 10 quid, so there we are, no problem.
So you were helping to move on.
I can't believe how long we've got. What
time is it now?
I've got another fabulous Jeremy clip I want to show, and I think maybe we ought to show that, move the Dalek into there, finish the fireside chat,
let them have a break,
and then come back for the evening show. You're all right, Beth? Do you want to see another fabulous Jeremy clip?
No.
This one also features the beautiful Tamara. Let's see if we can call it fabulous Jeremy. Okay.
Lovely music, isn't it?
It's from Jeremy's personal collection.
Redolent of the 70s.
As I said, you're going home with a Dalek. Come on, you got a Dalek. Do you remember when I was in there? That was funny. When